welcome everyone to Your Girls Right Now Friday Night Salon, Speak Your Truth with Jasmin Kaur. We are so excited and honored to have Jasmin here on her publishing week. And I am honored to pass it over to the wonderful poet and author of If I Tell You the Truth, released January 19th, Jasmin Kaur.
Hi, everybody. I am so excited to be here today. I have been excited for this since like November when we first started planning this workshop. And I'm so thrilled to be here with you all on Friday. We made it through the week. It's been like a long week of an already long year, and we have made it past the inauguration and things were okay this week. And I think that's something that I've definitely been smiling about for a while now. So I hope that you had a lovely week. And if you did not have a lovely week, I hope that this space brightens up your week a little bit, and that we're able to create a warm, positive, and safe space for you to listen and maybe to share if you'd like. But no pressure, always. It's always up to you, like we said, whether you'd like to share or not. So a little bit about me. I am a spoken word artist. That means that I write poetry that's meant to be performed out loud in front of audiences. I am also the author of When You Ask Me Where I'm Going and my new novel, If I Tell You the Truth, which just released this week on the 19th. And I'm so excited that this is finally out into the world and that I'm holding this book that was like in my brain for so long and then was on my laptop for so long and now is like this real actual thing sitting in front of me. It's the coolest thing ever. So I am the author of If I Tell You the Truth, and I also used to be a fourth grade teacher back in the day, and by back in the day I mean 2018, but I've been working full-time as an author for the last 2 years, and more recently I became a very amateur audiobook narrator. I got to narrate If I Tell You the Truth and When You Ask Where I'm Going, which if you enjoy audiobooks, you can always find that on Audible. That's a little bit about me. I am 28 years old and I began my journey as a writer back firmly when I was like 19 years old. In high school, in like the 12th grade, I discovered spoken word poetry through a friend who was like obsessed with like YouTube videos of like Def Jam poetry and Button poetry and that kind of thing. And we would just like scour YouTube together and watch these beautiful spoken word videos. I remember one of the first videos I encountered was by a poet named Sunny Patterson. And when I kind of discovered the world of spoken word as a listener, it was like a light bulb moment for me. Like it was the most beautiful, wonderful experience of just being able to listen to somebody speak and be moved to tears sometimes. It was the coolest, most beautiful thing ever. And at that time, like I was a huge fan of poetry, but I would never have identified myself as a writer or a poet. I was just an avid fan of the art form. And I loved poetry so much, and I started falling in love with poetry so much at that age that I wanted to organize open mic poetry nights with my friends in university. And we did not know what we were doing. We did not know how to organize an event. We did not know, you know, how to find artists and poets. We were just like two 19-year-olds trying to like celebrate this thing we loved in the best possible way we knew. But I remember that first event that we organized. I was putting together the list of artists when one of my friends was like, hey, why don't you perform a poem as well? And I was like, no, I'm not a poet. Like, that's not for me. I love poetry, but I don't think I can get up in front of people and perform. But I said, I love this one poem by Sunny Patterson so much that I want to just share it with the audience. So I wonder if I can just read it out loud. And I remember I was like, you know, reciting and reciting and reciting it and kind of like thinking about the way that Sunny puts so much emotion and honesty and fearlessness into her performance style, that suddenly I was like, what if I just try? Like, what if I just try to write something? What's the worst that could happen? I might embarrass myself, but that's okay. So I gave it a shot, and that was the first time I performed a poem. And the audience and my friends who were there were so supportive that I found the confidence through that to keep writing. And interestingly, I was a very shy kid. Like, I was a very shy teen. I still feel like I'm very much an introvert. And the idea of going in front of people and speaking and standing in front of a an audience with a mic in my hand, with like lights blaring in my face. Like, that was not my idea of a fun time. But through poetry, through that first event and so many events that followed, I found that I actually enjoyed it. Like, I found that I was actually enjoying this process of being able to share with others once I was able to let go of those fears and those anxieties slowly. So a lot of who I am today, a lot of my personality today is actually a product of finding my confidence through poetry and finding my voice through poetry. And that's what we're here to talk about today, how poetry, how going inside and kind of pulling out emotions through this art form can help you tap into yourself and to find your highest self and to get closer to who you are at your core. So after those initial years of kind of trying my hand at poetry in open mics, I decided to start sharing my poetry on Instagram. It was a few years after the open mics, actually. And something about being on the internet, like sharing poems with the world where they could everyone could see it and I couldn't see them, that terrified me. I was like very resistant to like posting any poems online. I didn't want anyone to see my writing. I didn't want anyone to, I knew that some people would like it, but I was terrified of people not liking it. So I just used that as my reason to avoid sharing my work publicly. And again, it was my friends. It was my friends who were encouraging me to share. My friends who shared their own poetry online, and I saw what a beautiful experience that was for them, who eventually inspired me to do the same. And one thing led to another, and my literary agent, she actually found me through my Instagram, and here I am a few years later with two books in my hand, all because I had this beautiful community of writers around me who kind of pushed me to engage in these mediums. And it was a bit of like a happily ever after in that sense. So I think for me, like, poetry has been the catalyst for all of this. I'm a fiction writer now. I wrote a bit of fiction when I was younger, but I'm writing fiction a lot more now. And poetry is the reason why I found the confidence to be able to write fiction. And I think that there's this beautiful honesty and vulnerability that we can find in poetry, especially contemporary poetry that encourages us to tap into our rawest feelings sometimes. And there's also something like liberating about being able to share so candidly through poems, whether the subject matter is, you know, anxiety or love or our fears or the things that just make us so angry or the injustices in the world. And there's also something that can be really terrifying about bearing your soul in front of an audience. And both things are totally valid. And I want to reflect on both of those tonight. But I think some of the most beautiful moments of my life have been at open mic nights, just sitting down and listening to somebody speak from their heart and pour their soul into a poem. I've never experienced anything more beautiful personally. So I'm so excited to be able to celebrate that with you all. So I am going to read a poem with you. This is a poem from my first book, When You Ask Me Where I'm Going, and we're talking about vulnerability tonight. And to me, this poem is like the encapsulation of what I mean when I say that there is power in being vulnerable. This is a poem that I wrote autobiographically. So not everything I write, not all the poems I write are autobiographical. Sometimes I write in character, sometimes I write in third person, sometimes I write in first person. But in this case, when I was writing this particular poem, I was speaking as me, as Jasmin. And I was tapping into some of my fears and my anxieties and the things that I'm confused about in life. And I felt comfortable sharing those in a poem and including those poems in my book, which would be shared publicly. And emphasis on I felt comfortable, because I don't always feel comfortable sharing everything that is in my mind. And that's a conversation we're going to have next about boundaries. So the poem reads, "You tell me that you are grateful that I am here, that the world is better for my presence, that maybe things would have been different if I never was, that maybe my being has helped another being be. And I am 25 years into this body, pouring into the ink black of your eyes, sitting atop a spherical classroom that my people know to be alive, wondering how to meet me, knowing that I will leave me, wondering how I found myself on this tightrope where I must walk until I let go. Wondering what I'm supposed to do with love if I am only learning how to wash it away. Wondering how much longing exists in all the spaces between space. Wondering if all the ache, all the separation between life and death still hangs somewhere in the air after centuries and centuries of all these humans yearning for love and God and themselves and each other. Wondering if the earth could even carry such a burden. Almost certain, but never certain, that sadness and suffering and fear can only exist in the minds of the living. Almost certain that somewhere between the fabric of oxygen and attachment and all my questions, there is a universe that is still and still breathing and okay. And the poem that follows this piece on the next page reads, I've tried boarding up the windows with deep breathing and changing all the locks on my thoughts. But when anxiety moves into my body, I am pushed out onto the street with nothing but a box of crushed courage and a few flimsy distractions to hold me over until she decides it is time to leave. So these two poems, they are definitely autobiographical. They are poems that deal with my own anxiety. And they were, I think they were very challenging to write and share with the world, because I think that there's something about digging into those tough places in ourselves where it can be hard to just share with others for very understandable reasons. And sometimes I feel like sharing and sometimes I don't. That's just human nature, I think, for all of us. But I found that sometimes when I share those things that feel so specifically me, feel like only I could be going through them and only I would understand, I'm always surprised to know that I am not alone and that those feelings are relatable. And I think that's the beauty of being human, that, you know, we are in this together. And sometimes we don't always realize that's the case. But going back to my original point, I think it's very important to recognize what you want to share with the world and what you don't want to share with the world. There are pieces of ourselves that we might feel obligated to share sometimes, but I think that is so important to know as a writer, as a creative writer, as an artist, that you get to decide what is that you want to put into your story. And you get to decide how you tell a story. You get to decide who that story reaches. And it's a beautiful thing to be able to create boundaries sometimes. As a person in my late 20s, I am all about boundaries. In my teens, in my early 20s, I wasn't so sure about boundaries. I didn't really know how to set them or like stick to them or assert them. I was kind of, maybe it came from the introvert part of myself, or maybe just the fact that girls are often taught that we need to be like really, really nice all the time. And for some reason, the world tells us that means that we can't be assertive in you know, what we're comfortable with and what we're not. But boundaries are so important, especially as artists. So for me, for example, I set a boundary, like a boundary with social media, by not always responding to every single DM that I get. Sometimes I'm just like tired, I'm emotionally burnt out, and I just don't have the capacity to respond to everything that comes my way. And that's an act of self-care for me, and it's a boundary for me. So the question I want to pose to everybody here is just, what is a boundary that you have created for yourself or want to create for yourself that you think will help with your self-care? So if you would like to share, feel free to drop that boundary in the chat box. And it doesn't have to be specific to creative writing or art. It could be anything in your life, anything with like the relationships in your life or anything along those lines. Oh, we're getting a bunch of awesome ones here. Okay, so I see being clear about when it's me time. Yes, that is so important, especially like in this day and age when like the internet and our phones are like in our faces all the time. And it feels like there is like no separation between us and the world. It's so important to be able to identify me time, not making myself always available for other people's negative emotions. Yeah. That is so important, knowing when you have the capacity to listen and when you don't, and not always feeling obligated when you just can't. We've got one that says, I think I need to get better at stopping things that make me uncomfortable, just assert myself because I know I deserve better than that. Yes, absolutely. Not saying yes every time someone asks for my help. Don't waste time and energy talking to someone that refuses to listen. Setting a hard stop for working from home every day, 5 p.m. Yes, absolutely. not engaging in conversations that don't serve me. Say no to toxic people trying to come back into my life. Not everyone deserves my time. Not saying yes every time someone wants to chat on Zoom when I'm tired or not in the mood. Sometimes I'm overwhelmed or tired and I just don't want to talk. If my siblings try to talk to me, I just let them know, and usually they're pretty okay about it. Talking can be exhausting to me. As an introvert, I know exactly what you mean. I think choosing what I want to share with the public and what I do not want to share with the public is a boundary I want to assert more. Absolutely. Conserving my energy, not engaging other people's guilt, setting limits for news intake. Yes, absolutely. Tweaking my habits to prevent mechanical living, but also realizing habits are okay. Acknowledging my feelings, even if they are dismissed by people. Saying no to phone calls when you've hit the fatigue threshold. Yes, very much yes to that. And knowing when to turn off any negative emotion. And this is great. This is so beautiful to see that like boundaries are a part of so many of our lives. And like I said before, I think that boundaries are self-care, because it can be exhausting to constantly be dealing with, social interactions in the world that, and interactions that don't serve us. So I'm thrilled to see those boundaries declared by you all. So shifting gears a little bit, I am going to now read a poem from If I Tell You the Truth. And this poem is written by the character Sahara in the novel. So speaking a little bit about the novel, If I Tell You the Truth is the story of a Punjabi mother and daughter living in Canada and dealing with the Canadian immigration system. This is a system that is not built for the safety of marginalized people. And simultaneously, they are up against a very powerful public figure who has caused them harm. And they are trying to navigate how it is that they can use their voices and find their voices to right things that have gone really wrong. And in the novel, once you read it, you'll see that there's a lot of conversation about art, about the struggles of speaking up and finding your voice, and how art itself, poetry and visual art, can be a source of healing, a source of rest, joy, how art and visual art specifically can help heal anxiety. So the character Sahara, she is a visual artist, and she paints and draws and creates when she's feeling anxious, especially because that for her, that's like self-care. And that's how she heals from her anxiety. She also uses poetry to channel her rawest of raw emotions. So like me, Sahara finds a lot of strength in poetry. And that's why part of the novel is actually written in her poems, and the poems are all in her voice and her mom's voices. So this poem that I'm going to share, I don't want to give away too many spoilers about the book, so I won't give you a ton of context, but Sahara is very angry, and she is reflecting on how she wants to speak up about the things she is angry about, the injustice she's angry about, but she's not sure how, and she doesn't know if she has the courage to do what she wants to do. So she is drawing inspiration to find her voice, to tap into the activist spirit through a character from a movie that she really loves. So I'm not sure if you guys have seen The Girl with the Dragon Tattoo. If you have, feel free to just let me know in the chat box. But The Girl with the Dragon Tattoo, Lisbeth, she's a huge source of inspiration for Sahara. And for a little bit of context, Lisbeth is a character who fights injustice, who especially seeks justice against, people who have caused harm to marginalized people, especially women, through like her own version of vigilante justice. And watching this film, when Sahara watched this film, she found a lot of strength and bravery and awe and wonder from that character. So you're going to see a character talking about another character from a different book, if that makes sense. The title is At 4 in the Morning. Mom and BBG are awake for Amrit Vela meditation. And I rewatch The Girl with the Dragon Tattoo. Learning, studying, seeking catharsis from the only superhero who deserves the title. Like muscle memory, I know the scenes that make me tremble, the parts I need to skip, the parts I need to rewind and play again and again and again. I pause at the exact moment when Lisbeth stands in the elevator, fingers outstretched, reaching for his forehead, making him cower in fear at a woman he will never dare to touch again. I wish I could write to her, will her into existence, churn her into more than words on paper and compelling acting before a camera, pray to her like a patron saint, leave an offering of white peonies and thornless roses at her feet. I wish I could find Elizabeth within me. So that was Sahara's self-reflection as she's watching this film. And I think it encapsulates so much of what I mean when I say that poetry is a way of channeling our rawest of raw emotions, tapping into our vulnerable feelings, tapping into our righteous anger, because I think that anger can be a beautiful, important thing, especially in the face of so much injustice. And as we think about that self-reflection, I want us to shift over to a writing activity. So in this writing activity, we are going to be journaling for ourselves. Oftentimes as creative writers, we tend to write with like a reader in our brain. We kind of almost see the audience before we even let ourselves put pen to paper or just begin typing. We start thinking, okay, what is someone going to think of this piece of writing? Do I need to edit this? Is my, are my metaphors like good? Do I need to switch everything up? Am I being succinct? And we have all these like editorial thoughts in our brains that we've kind of been conditioned to process and think about before we are even able to start writing. And I personally find that when I have this constant thought of an audience in my mind, it actually stops me from writing. It kind of creates a sense of writer's block for me because I get so caught up and so worried about what my audience is going to think of my writing that I feel like I just can't write. And I don't know if that's like a relatable feeling, but that's definitely like what I experience. So when I let go of the fear of an audience, when I give myself license to write, knowing that my writing is just for me, that's when things start naturally flowing. So in this activity, you are writing just for you. If at the end you'd like to share an excerpt of what you write, you definitely can, but there is like no pressure to share this with anyone in the world. This is all about you. And in this activity, you've got this prompt right here on the screen that says, I am free when. And all you have to do is begin with that prompt and let that prompt take you wherever it wants to take you. There is no right or wrong answer. There is no specific direction you have to go. It's whatever that means for you in this moment and wherever your mind naturally wants to go. And I want you to treat it kind of like a stream of consciousness. Instead of kind of trying to edit as you're writing and stopping and kind of rethinking your lines, just keep writing and writing and writing and see whatever comes to your mind with no pressure at all. And I want you to try your very best to not stop writing until I say stop. So try not to pick your pen up off the paper for too long and just keep going and going and going. And even if you hate what you write, that's all good. I just want to challenge you to keep kind of digging for ideas. And if possible, no pressure as well, but see if you can incorporate metaphors and similes as you go. A simile is when you compare two unlike things by using the word like or as, and metaphor is when you do the exact same thing, but don't use the word like or as. So if you'd like to incorporate metaphors and similes, definitely go ahead. And one last wrench I'm going to throw in to the middle of there. As you're writing, I am going to give you random words. So I've got four words that I'm going to throw out at you. And your job is going to be to try your best to incorporate these words somewhere along your piece of writing. So let's say I call out the word water. You would try your best to include, you know, water or watered or watering or some iteration of that word somewhere along your piece of writing, however it naturally kind of fits in. So that is the plan. If there's any questions ahead, I can take a look at the chat right now. Otherwise, we will begin. Don't see any questions. Okay. So we can begin now. So the first word is water. So try to kind of naturally incorporate that word somewhere along your lines.
Just to see if it's true. You can't leave.
And the next word is roots. And the next word is replenish. And the final word is bloom. And from here, kind of wrap up those final thoughts, finish that sentence you're working on. And when you're ready, you can just put down your pencil or look back up at the screen. Okay, so about 10 more seconds if you're just wrapping up your thoughts. Personally, I find it, I tend to find it very enlightening. It kind of pulls things out of me that I didn't know were there, wasn't necessarily very conscious of. Was it a positive experience? It was intense. It's like you took the words right out of my brain. That was so odd. I feel like I know what I need now. Cathartic, yes. That's like a word that I often get when we do this activity. Refreshing, but also a little unnerving. How much anxiety coursed through every sentence for me. And if it was an anxiety, if it drew out some anxiety for you, maybe you just hold space for that, hold space for those feelings. Breathe with yourself, breathe deeply. Know that you are in a warm, positive, and supportive space of folks who are here, and appreciate you as you are. And you learned a lot about yourself. I have the exact same experience often when I do this activity. I discover things about myself that I wasn't always aware of. It was hard to let go of the feeling that I need to make my words pretty. Yes. 100% relatable. I think that it's so important sometimes to turn off the editorial brain so that we can get to parts of ourselves that exist beneath the editorial brain that are so beautiful and so creative. So from here, we have like so much fertile content now with which to jump into our next activity, our final writing activity for the night. So what I would like you to do now is take another read of these beautiful pieces that you have written, and find the lines that you are most drawn to, maybe like one or two lines or one or two metaphors or something along those lines. And imagine ways in which you could take those lines, cut them out of this piece, and create an entirely brand new piece where this poem was, or when this stream of consciousness activity was created just for you to be able to journal and reflect and get things off of your chest. Imagine now as you're writing that you have an audience in mind, that you are writing and you might be planning to share this with someone else. As you're writing this entirely new poem or prose piece from the piece that you just wrote, I want you to think about it now with that audience in mind, with that editorial lens back on in your mind. Think about how you would edit it if you were in an editorial workshop. Think about how you would edit it if you were a peer editor. Think about how you'd edit it to make sure that you are conveying your message as clearly as possible to your reader. So again, you are going to be taking a couple of lines or one line from that original piece and crafting an entirely new poem or prose piece from that. And I'm going to give you about 7 minutes to work on that. So you can start kind of cultivating a new idea now. It's the beginning of my sermon. You hold my hand as an infant. Palms to the sky, Adonai, Yahweh, till they all come down, till we all fall down. Lines drawn in the sun, keep the sun like your back, keep your feet firmly planted in the sky, just right. When you don't know yourself, if it hurts you to explain, you're good in my eyes, just mountains are my fingertips. Oh, as
yelling at the TV, screaming at the top of my lungs, tears in my eyes.
About 2 minutes left to keep working on your piece. About 30 seconds left.
I travel 70 states. Thought moving around make me feel better. I tried to
And let's come back together now. So wrap up those last thoughts, that last sentence you're working on. And thank you so much for the beautiful writing that you've already shared in this space. I'm so excited to see what we've come up with after that revision process. So I'm so grateful that we got to create such a warm, positive space here tonight. And from here, I will end this segment of the salon, and then we will move on to our Q&A.
Are you related to Rupi Kaur? I'm not sure if I'm saying that right.
So no, I am not. And it's interesting because I get this question a lot. And actually, all Sikh women, most Sikh women choose to take on the last name Kaur, because it's a way of challenging the casteist and kind of classist meanings and past history of South Asian last names. So in typical or in historical South Asian last names, there's a social class denoted within that title. And those social classes have caused harm to people for centuries and centuries, and have caused some people to be treated as less than and some people to be treated as better than others. So by taking on the last name Kaur, we kind of all collectively choose to say that we are going to live as equals. And I think it's such a beautiful, but not so often understood aspect of like Sikh identity, because I actually get this question a lot.
There are a few questions, all these hearts coming through are beautiful. There are a few questions in the chat, starting with, what was the hardest part of publishing your books? The hardest part of the process?
Yeah. So with my first book, when you asked me where I'm going, what was nice about writing that book was that I had been collecting poems that I wanted to put into a book for years. So there are poems in that book that I wrote 7 to 8 years ago. And then there are some that I wrote, 2 years ago. And it was this slow kind of buildup and collecting of things. Whereas for my next book, If I Tell You the Truth, I was starting from scratch. There was nothing on the page. Well, there was one chapter, but generally there's not a lot there to go with. So I had a timeline, I had a deadline, and I had a goal in mind for how many words I wanted to write a day. And I had to just kind of treat it less as waiting for inspiration to come along and hit me over the head, and more as a dedicated goal-oriented commitment where I was getting up at 9 in the morning, sitting down at my desk, writing whether I felt inspired or not inspired to meet those daily word goals. And I actually found that having or developing that kind of discipline of just deciding that you're going to sit down and write a book and committing to it day in and day out, it was really, really emotionally taxing at times, but it was also really helpful in that sometimes I needed a word goal to be able to push myself out of my writer's block, in the sense that I often feel stuck when I'm waiting for inspiration versus if I sit there and tell myself that I've got it right, inspiration kind of just happens. It's this beautiful, magical thing. So it was challenging to write like that, but it was necessary and also such a beautiful learning experience. And it was all of that combined into one. So I think that's the biggest challenge. I think just forcing yourself to do the work day in and day out and come back to your desk when you're not having a great day sometimes, but know that the end result of you kind of pushing yourself out of that comfort zone is this beautiful thing that you get to hold in your hands and that can transport people to another world, and bring joy and strength and comfort to people. It's the most beautiful thing. It's the most challenging thing, but I wouldn't trade it for the world.
There was a question.
Yeah.
Sorry, there was a question after that from Atika, who says, how do you build characters? It's really hard for me to create them, especially as a prose writer.
Yeah. So poetry for me feels like my first language. Fiction writing came after poetry. So I feel the most intuitive when I'm writing poems. So for me, because poetry has always been closest to my heart. I tend to write poems from the voices of my characters before I even begin writing the story, which sounds like weird, because the poems actually don't go anywhere. They don't really end up in the books sometimes. It's just more of like a writing exercise for myself. And I like to write poems from the perspective of my characters because I find that in poetry, I'm able to tap right into my emotions, cut straight to the root of what I'm feeling or thinking. And to know a character that intimately, to be able to write a poem from their heart, I think it helps you to kind of situate them mentally and then situate them in their environment. The other thing I find really helpful is just like worksheets. So you can find these online usually that just help you answer questions about your character. So I've seen worksheets that'll say things like, if your character was having a really bad day, where would they go? If your character could only hang out with, you know, one person for the rest of their life, who would that person be? And it forces you to kind of think about things you would never typically think about when you're writing a scene or when you're writing something specific. It forces you to kind of expand who they are into like a whole holistic person who is complicated, just as human as a living, breathing person. And I think once you've got that holistic perspective on like who they are as people, then it becomes easier and more intuitive to put them into situations, to put them into different settings in your story and know how they would react.
Then there's one more question from the top, I think, before these more recent questions. Samit asks, have you ever found writing to be a spiritual experience?
I think so. I think that writing feels like it helps me get right into who I am deep down. I think that is the most beautiful spiritual thing for me, just tapping into who I am. And I've gotten closest to who I am through art, through poetry, through music, and especially like through writing, and especially through journaling. I think that when we journal, we're able to kind of have conversations with ourselves that we don't always get to have on a day-to-day basis when we're so caught up in like everything around us externally. When we're caught up in school and like our family and like interpersonal conflicts and all these kinds of things that just like happen, we kind of get disconnected from ourselves. So I think writing helps me come back inside when I've been outside for a very long time, if that makes sense. So I think Isel says, so do you have any advice for incoming authors and any advice for starting to write books after graduating high school? So the first thing I want to say is know that your voice matters. Know that your voice is important and it needs to be heard in this world. Oftentimes when I doubt myself, when I question, you know, whether writing is really for me, I ask myself whether the world would be a better place if my voice was just absent from it. And the answer to that is no. The world would not be a better place. And that simple answer, that act of telling myself no, is what keeps me going sometimes. It keeps me motivated. And I think that when I was in my undergrad, when I was studying English in university, I loved writing. I loved storytelling. I loved poetry. But I didn't necessarily think that my love for poetry and writing and fiction would translate into a book one day. I just didn't think that that was a realistic dream. It felt like ending up in the NBA. Like it just felt like too disconnected. And I was like, it's a cool concept, but it's never gonna happen. And if I could go back in time and talk to myself back in the day, I would say, believe in yourself enough to know that if you want this badly enough, it is going to happen. And carry yourself now as if that's where you're going. Because it's only going to strengthen you when that day comes, because that day will come, because, you know, you're sitting here and you want this that badly, and this means that much to you. That would be a message to myself, and I think that would also be my message to other young authors, to know the value of your voice, to not let the world shake that inherent trust that you have in yourself as a storyteller. The other thing I often say is that writers, poets need to be armed with both deep-rooted humility and ridiculous confidence, because you need to have the humility to know that, you know, you're going to be growing. Your writing next year is going to be different than what it is today. And in 3 years, it's stronger. And, you know, 5 years is going to be even stronger. But that doesn't mean that your writing right now isn't good enough. And it doesn't mean that you should stop writing because you're not there right now. On the flip side as well, you need to be armed with so much confidence that when you get those critiques that come from a place of love, but also come from a place of wanting to strengthen your work, it fortifies you as a writer and doesn't make you feel like the task is too big. You need to just arm yourself with that ridiculous confidence that you can get to the edit and celebrate your work all through the process. It's a challenge. And I say that knowing that I struggle with it as a published author with two books. I still struggle with those things, but I tell myself that all the time as I have those doubts. What apps do you use to make your Instagram poetry posts? So I actually have been designing my Instagram posts on my laptop like since forever. I use Photoshop and Adobe Illustrator. When I do a drawing on Instagram that accompanies my poems, I will draw it on Adobe Illustrator on my laptop, and then I'll save it and then email it to myself and then post it on Instagram. So it's a bit of a process. What books or authors inspire you? I've got like a stack of books in front of me, which I want to share with you guys, because I think that some of you will really love these. So I've got Blood and Honey in front of me by Shelby Mahurin. This is the sequel to Serpent and Dove. And it's a fantasy romance novel about a witch who falls in love with a witch hunter. And I read the first book last year and I was just obsessed with it. And I had to pick up the second book. And the covers are so pretty. Like it's hard not to want to just like grab that book. So that's one of my favorites. I've also got The Invisible Life of Addie LaRue. This is another fiction fantasy novel. And it's historical fiction about a girl who becomes immortal, but the trade-up for being immortal is that no one remembers her. So it's from her perspective, and the writing is really like lyrical and poetic. So if you're interested in seeing like how metaphors can be used in fiction, this is like a really good book to read. And I've also got a copy of a book that's not been published yet. It's coming out in April, so I'm so excited that I have an ARC. This is Witches Steeped in Gold by Shannon Smart, about two warring witches. It's inspired by Shannon's Jamaican culture. Beautiful writing. So if you're into like witchy YA teen novels, like this is the one. It's really, really good. So these are the authors that inspire me. And I think that if you want to be an awesome writer, like reading is like fundamental. Reading is a part of that process. So I'm always trying to pick up books as I'm writing, just to stay inspired by what is possible for a story. One more question says, do you have any advice for how to truly write for yourself without the pressure of a hypothetical audience? I think that's a work in progress for myself. I think sometimes just really sitting there and saying, okay, with this piece of writing that I'm writing, no one is going to see it. I don't have to stress about anyone seeing it. That in itself, just telling yourself that and sticking to it can be what you need to do. Knowing that it's okay to like make a mess, be silly, just write things that might, you know, that you might not be into like the next day once you read it back, knowing that there's nothing bad that's going to happen if you write something that you hate, is such an important thing. And it's a process. It's like building a muscle the same way that writing is building a muscle. Building that comfort in writing vulnerably is also a muscle that you need to keep like working on. It comes with time and patience. So be patient with yourself, trust the process, because it'll come slowly sometimes. Mary has to jump off. Thank you so much for coming. Michelle says, as an immigrant, my grammar is poor at times and that stops me from writing most of the time. As a first timer here today, this really gives me a little bit more confidence. Thank you. I'm so glad to hear that. And I think that that is such a real struggle. And we, you know, we live in a world sometimes that tells us that, you know, a colonizer's language is the most important language, and fluency in that language is like supposedly important, and I challenge that. I confront that and I reject it. And I so appreciate that you shared that thought with us. Currently in a reading rut, any advice? And by the way, heard so much about Serpent and Dove. My thought on a reading rut is the same as like a writing rut. You kind of just have to sit down, and commit to something, whether you're committing to like writing 100 words a day or you're committing to reading one chapter of your book or reading one page of your book, it's that commitment sometimes that forces us out of that pause moment. And also knowing that like it's okay to have ruts sometimes, like it's okay to just like step away and not need to want to read anything and just want to write instead, or just want to draw instead, or just want to like, you know, binge watch your favorite. So Jasmin says, have you been able to train or quiet your inner critic? Still very much a work in progress. And I also want to say, like, I am in a master's program right now, filled with authors, filled with poets, filled with creative writers. And my professor, one of my professors in the master's program, had a whole conversation with all of us as writers about how we need to be kinder to ourselves. And we need to work with our inner critic and not work against it sometimes. So I want to just reaffirm that, like, all of us struggle with this. It's definitely not something that happens in isolation. I think it's like a universal thing as authors and as writers, where we are sometimes our own worst critics. So don't feel alone. That's definitely like a universal, even your favoriteest author in the whole world has probably had those exact same thoughts and questioned themselves in the exact same way. Any other, did I miss anything? I think I caught, so Maya says, do you think that the characters and stories we tell reveal the deepest parts of ourselves? How do you deal with that less obvious vulnerability? Yeah, I think I've heard this thing that like the first novel that we often write has ourselves in it somewhere, even if it's fiction. Like one of the characters usually sounds a lot like us, and we need to get that bit of ourselves out in order to go on to the next book where the character really isn't us. So I think that fiction can be a beautiful way to process our own feelings. And the most beautiful fiction comes from our own experiences. It comes from tapping into those bits of ourselves that we don't always get to tap into in our day-to-day lives. And it's when we're writing from that place of honesty and sincerity and what is familiar to us, that folks are like, okay, I get this. This speaks to me. This speaks to my heart. This is relatable. And it's so funny how that happens. What first inspired you to write? So in high school, before I discovered spoken word poetry online, I picked up a book, a poetry book by the Sufi poet Rumi. And Rumi is a poet who lived hundreds upon hundreds of years ago. And his work, or their work, is still translated to this day and still in print to this day. And I was so struck by the fact that I was reading these poems by this person who is hundreds of years old, but I could still relate so personally as if we were just having a conversation today. And that's where it came from. I was just like mesmerized and in awe of the fact that someone could write something in so few words and touch my heart in such a meaningful way. And I was like, whatever this is, like I need to tap into it as well. Because I'm feeling resonance here that I've never felt before.
I have a question. Can I ask it out loud? How to put it into words. But I think like for me, as also like a woman of color whose writing is like very personal, like something that I keep coming back to is like how this can be representative of others' experiences and the way that that can be read. And so trying to be conscious of that while also staying true to like my story. I don't really know what I'm asking, but it's just like, a lot of times I find it easier to talk about the stuff that's hard about being like a woman of color and just the obstacles in my life. But I also don't want that to be all that my story is, because there's so much more than that. And so like, how do you manage that without your writing? Does that make sense?
That totally makes sense. And I experienced a lot of that as a young poet. I think the first 3 or 4 years of my poetry, it was the hardest stuff I'd been through. That was what was coming out in my writing. It was a lot of those angry experiences and those things that took me to sadness. And I truly feel like I needed to get that out of my system. I needed to share all of that as it was without apology so that I could get to the brighter stuff. because it was a cathartic experience for me, and it was a healing experience for me, to just be able to bring words to things that were for so long unspoken and very confusing. So I would say let yourself be okay with that process, and also appreciate your self-awareness of that, because your story is all of it, and not just one segment. So giving yourself license, and giving yourself that bit of like that love, to know that all elements of your story are relevant and important and valuable and deserve to be heard. I think that's the key. Yusel says, do you recommend self-publishing or traditional publishing? So I actually can't speak to self-publishing because I didn't self-publish, so I don't know too much about that personally. What I do really like about the traditional publishing process is that when you're publishing with an established publishing house, they help you with printing the book, editing the book, marketing the book, sending the book out to bookstores and all that kind of stuff, which was helpful for me because I wasn't sure how to market my books independently and on my own. And that's kind of, I think, the thing that you have to do when you're self-publishing. You have to kind of be all parts of the publisher on your own. And I think that some authors, some friends of mine who are self-published, they really like that because they like that creative control over all bits of the process. And some people don't like it so much. So it's like there's no like rule of which way is like the way. There's like pros and cons to either way. But I can't really speak to it from personal experience, unfortunately. And I think that's all for questions.
Yeah, it looks like that was the last question.
Awesome.
Thank you so much, Jasmin. This has been absolutely full. There's so much knowledge and insight and poetry that you shared with us today. And I just want to ask if everyone who's here could just unmute yourself and give Jasmin just the warmest round of applause and woohoo and thank you so much you can.
Congrats, Jasmin!
Thank you. That was very inspiring.
Thank you,
Jasmin.
Thank
you.
Thank you.
Yes.
Oh, yes. Thank you, guys.
Absolutely amazing, Jasmin, and the writing that was here tonight. I think you're not only a wonderful writer, but you're an amazing teacher. And I just am glad that was shared with the audience tonight. And for everyone who's here, you can see how to keep in touch, keep involved in everything that Jasmin's doing. You can follow her on Instagram, on Twitter. She has her email shared with you today. So if there's something you wanted to follow up about, you can send it to Jasmin. Kaur.enquiries@gmail.com. And then of course, many of you have said that you have If I Tell You the Truth and that you're excited to read it, which is so awesome to see. If you don't have it, go purchase. We've dropped a link inside the chat. You have to read it. We just enjoy Jasmin so much and we're excited for all the things that you're going to do and to keep being a part of it. You are so welcome in this Girls Right Now community, and I know that you've influenced this audience in a really great way. So I just have to say thank you again to Jasmin. I also want to say thank you to, of course, the essential workers. There was also a shout out to teachers tonight, so I want to thank teachers. I want to thank advocates and activists out in the world right now. Our world is hectic, and we're making it through. And it's to the thanks of all the people out there who wake up every day and put their lives on the line in different ways. So essential workers, teachers, grocery stores, anywhere you are, we appreciate you and we thank you for your work. I also wanna say that if you don't know about Girls Right Now, if you're not sure how to be involved, I want to show you the way. Of course, you can donate. Go to girlsrightnow.org/give to support more programs like this. All of our public programs are free. The ones that we put on and that we host are free. And it's because of the donations that all of you all send and help us to put out programming like this. You can also become a Circle member and receive special benefits. That's girlsrightnow.org/circle. And of course, if you're interested in becoming a mentee or a mentor, you can go to girlsrightnow.org/inquiry and find out how you can mentor the next generation of young women and gender nonconforming writers, or how you can be a part of the next generation, which you already are, but come to our program and find that structure. Jasmin, it has been amazing to collaborate with you, to work with you on this workshop. Is there anything you want to say about why you're aligning with Girls Right Now?
Yeah, I have been a fan of Girls Right Now ever since I first discovered them, like way earlier this year. This past summer, like, I joined one of the Girls Right Now events as a guest and as a participant. It was a salon about screenwriting, and I learned so much. I found the confidence in that workshop as a participant to go and take a screenwriting course in my university. So I've like benefited so much from being a learner in this space, and to be able to give back to that space that does this amazing work is like the most exciting, rewarding thing ever. So I'm so grateful to be here, and I'm so grateful that organizations like this exist.
Thank you. And that's really awesome that you took that screenwriting course. I knew you were in the workshop, but that's cool that it propelled you to do the next thing, which is what it's all about, like putting the words to action. So that's really awesome. And thank you so much for saying that. And then lastly, I'll say, if you share your work, if you share anything about the salon, tag us, tag Jasmin. Let us know how you felt, how it went, how your writing was. Share your writing. We are happy to retweet, to be a part, and to share your work. You can go to girlsrightnow.org/calendar to see all of our upcoming events. And you can go to girlsrightnow.org just to learn more. Either way, we are so thankful for having you here tonight, and have a good rest of your night, everyone. See you later.
Thank you. This is amazing. Good night.
Good night.